So good morning. So this is the first of two engineering presentations. So it's like intermediate entertainment, I guess, for you. So the purpose, more precisely, is to list the main design issues which have arisen during the development of Huygens and why it was chosen, and then to evaluate these choices in front of the result which have been obtained from an engineering point of view. And then, okay, when relevant, there is some lessons learned to be taken from this experience as well for future mission, maybe, hopefully. So for us, it was as well a very long story. We started in 90, in fact, in spring 90, by bidding to a proposal from the European Space Agency. And for a kickoff, which has happened, in fact, in 91. So I just start by recalling what were the specifications of Huygens at the very beginning of this story, in fact. So the spec was pretty simple, although it was 160 pages long. It was to build a probe to descend into the Titan atmosphere during a certain time, I mean, specified time, with a certain spin profile for the instrument. After it being released from Cassini orbiter and have been spent 7 years in flight. Yeah. In flight, it means, in flight and after having, followed the Cassini trajectory, Venus, Earth, Jupiter, gravity assist. There was an environmental spec, and this is the Titan as it was specified in the original ESA requirement spec. So it's not very big, and that's all what specified at that time, in fact. So the, I guess we knew more about Titan, but okay, maybe not. And the atmosphere model was the Lelouchian 10 model, so you know it. And this model has been the baseline until launch, in fact. Also, there was a yield model which was studied by ESA at some time, but it was never passed to the industry. So this is the model which has been used for the design of the front shield and the descent system. There was another requirement, of course. It was to accommodate the payload. At that time, there were several instruments, the six we all know, plus another one, which is Astra, which was a subsurface sounder. So at proposal time, there was that instrument as well. Yeah. There was a requirement to send to these instruments some information during the descent, which was the altitude and the spin. So we had, of course, to measure all this stuff, transmit to Cassini, survive 3 minutes on the surface. So this was a spec, okay? Actually, it was only addressing the resources, the energy, which we had to size for 3 minutes more on the surface. And the launch date at that time was 95. So it was in 90. So then, there was another thing, yes, is we had on Cassini a dedicated probe relay antenna, which was a steerable antenna dedicated to acquire Huygens data while transmitting in real time this data to Earth. So there was no receiver ultrastable oscillator. It was supposed to be on ground, because the transmission was a real-time transmission from Huygens to the Earth. There was no storage of the information on Cassini. And because of that, this antenna was 1.2 meter diameter, if I remember well. So there was not one single data rate from Huygens to Cassini. There were three data rates, 2, 4, and 8, depending on the descent time. So the overall science return was much less. There was a request to instrument the front shield to put pressure and temperature sensors. And we had to measure the altitude, from 170 kilometers. So this was what was required. At 91, it was a kickoff of the industrial activity, so just after the December 90 meeting you have seen photographs of. So the instrument, the Astra instrument, was immediately canceled, which was very good. Yes, we were quite happy of that. It was difficult to accommodate. We had no more the requirement to measure the altitude from 170 kilometers, but to obtain the altitude, let's say, to distribute the altitude to the instrument from that altitude, from there. And the launch immediately became, in fact, 1997. And this is a trajectory on the left, which was specified from 91. And on the right, you have the trajectory which was achieved. And you can compare, there are 2 days of difference in the launch date and 5 days of difference in the arrival in Saturn. So in 91, it was, I mean, we met exactly the specification for that part of the mission, at least. And also Cassini met it. Okay, this is the planning of the mission. There was a review, there are the models also, but I wanted to put the two main events, which are the Galileo launch, which was just before Huygens start, and the descent of the Galileo probe into Jupiter atmosphere, which was before the end of the development phase. So we could benefit of these two events for the design of Huygens. So there was a very big, important event also for Huygens. There was a big mass reduction exercise, a cost also, I think, on Cassini's side. I think it was in 92, which led to suppress the probe relay antenna on Cassini's side. And for that reason, Cassini has to point Huygens with its Huygens antenna. So this was very favorable to us because we immediately had a very huge link margin. So we could have increased the data rate, in fact, so the science return immediately. And with the drawback that we had to put a receiver ultrastable oscillator on the orbiter side, in fact. During the development, there was also some events. It turned out that we needed more information that we had on Titan, in fact. So we needed information for lightning, for triboelectricity, which appeared to be present there, the surface reflectivity in RF for the radar measurement, the wind gust profiles, and there was also, yes, some information to assess the possibility of icing during the descent. All this for all this, we needed the strong support of the science team, obviously, because, all this was addressed in the frame of the Huygens science working teams, in fact. And in the course of development, we had more and more specification for the environment that we had at the beginning. So, okay, there was no lightning, but it was designed for support certain lightning, much weaker than on Earth, but still. And there was tests for that. Triboelectricity, we implemented dischargers. These are the Concorde dischargers, which we have on Huygens. We had to discuss with the aeroplane people, we were the same company at that time. It was Aerospatial. So for effectivity for the radar, I think Jonathan Lunin made a paper on that, and so on. So, well, and this helped to design the probe. And so, as I mentioned, there is the enter of the Galileo probe into Cassini. So, yes, I will come back on that later. So there was two main criteria to design that probe, and one, the essential criteria, was the robustness. And this has driven not all of the technical choices. And this criteria has also be used to implement significant margins in many areas. So we had to have a huge margin because we were going to some unknown area, in many areas actually. So there was a big margin in energy, the entry fluxes, we had margin. The link budget, we have huge margin, okay, fortunately. The thermal control as well, there was a lot of margin. And the EMC compatibility, we tested the probe, which much stronger level that we would have actually. So the selection of the most robust option, of course. And we have implemented also backup. So backup, it means totally different technical solutions for the most critical functions, which were the wake-up of the probe after the coast phase, and the detection of the entry. So this function was completely backed up by another solution. And then also to gain robustness, we had a conservative development, or not only development, but development and verification plan. We have proper engineering model, STPM, flight model, qualification models. We had some test plan which were consistent with the objective, with model, special model for the verification of the descent subsystem. And we did, well, actually, we could do a significant amount of tests, and very few of them were relaxed, in fact. And then the second criteria was the launch date, obviously, because, I mean, we could not miss it for many, many reasons. So I come back now to the design choices, and I go through each, well, not each, many subsystems and function one by one to see how it was done, why, and briefly how it has behaved. So for the front shield, there was roughly three technologies which were assessed. The first one, the front shield, is the heat shield, which protects the probe during the descent. Yeah. So it was a beryllium front shield, which was immediately considered as too heavy and also too risky to develop and very hard to handle. Okay, it's beryllium. The second solution was a more credible, I would say. It was a carbon-carbon entry shield. And this one, there was a risk because we had never built, well, they had never been built such big structures in carbon at that time. Therefore, the third solution was based on an ablative material on an aluminum structure. And this had the benefit to be known and used already in military applications. And we were working in a company, well, Aerospatial at that time was in charge of this as well, so it was rather good. And the process was known, in fact. For the front shield, there was immediately a decision to remove any instrumentation of this. Okay, it's bad maybe for engineering feedback at the end, but it was clearly good for the development, and it allowed not to mix the constraints in fact. So the ablative option, as you know, was chosen. So this is a front shield. Yes, you know it, with a typical south of France tiles. And this front shield, I mean, this technique in well, has been favorable in the development because it has allowed to, at a certain time, to accommodate much higher fluxes, because we had discovered, in fact, the fact that the recombination of the species which are decomposed by the shock wave are much faster on Titan than they are on Earth. And so it leads to a very high infrared radiation, in fact, on the front shield instead of on the plume, in fact, of the descent body. And this increased significantly the fluxes during the development. And this could easily be accommodated with the solution which was taken. The result, the result is that it has worked, in fact, so we cannot say more apart from that. The instrumentation we had on the probe shows that it has worked in the sense that the temperature inside the probe did not basically increase during the entry, so the front shield, well, it increased very small way, so the front shield behaved well in the sense that it was a cold structure, in fact, type of entry shield. And well, what we can say as well is that, yes, the decision not to have instrumentation there was probably bad for to analyze the data afterwards, but it was clearly good for the development and the robustness of the probe. Now the descent system, these are the parachutes, in fact, the set of parachutes. So the Huygens shape is unstable during the transonic regime. And for that reason, the descent system has to open in a supersonic regime and cross the transonic area with the parachutes already deployed. So that shape has driven the need for this pilot chute and the deployment of this supersonic parachute. This was the first thing. Then a third parachute had to be installed to ensure a descent profile or descent time consistent with the visibility of Cassini in the horizon. We could have had a much longer descent, and staying with the main chute would have led to a descent maybe, I don't know, 6 hours or 7 hours long. So we had to have a third parachute. And then there was requirement for stability during the descent, coming from stability, well, not to miss the link, and also, of course, coming from the imaging requirements. All that led to a not very simple descent system design because of the various constraints. We have in the end three parachutes which are opened one after the other one, so each of them is a single point failure, it's not extremely good for the reliability, but we had to implement that in the end. So the robustness there was gained by the choice of the contractor, which was a very experienced contractor in that area. In fact, they are building ejection seats. And so in fact, we had very good contractor for this parachute, and this has helped a lot. So it has been, the way it has behaved, well, overall, it has behaved very well during the mission. However, we have to say also the black side. There was some discrepancy noticed, in fact. Well, the inflation time was a bit longer, in fact, for each of the three parachutes. Well, this doesn't really matter, but okay. More important that we had probably lower drag coefficient for the pilot chute and the main chute, while slightly higher drag coefficient for the third parachute, which probably led to, well, this probably led to have a descent time which was actually long. It was just 3 minutes shorter than maximum descent time we were designed for. So this is probably things. And then there was an excessive motion under the third parachute, oscillation, which were not dumped, and this was not really designed for or expected, yes. Well, the last bullet is, well, there are the lessons learned. The fact is, mainly for the, well, also for the drag coefficient as well, it was things were seen during the test, but also for the oscillation under the third parachute, this was seen during this SM2 test, the balloon test in Sweden. There were things seen there, and probably it was not deeply enough analyzed. Otherwise, maybe things would have been understood before the mission itself. That's a pity. The thermal control, I will go faster. Okay, it was a very complex system because of the different environment, the cruise phase called attached to Cassini, the coast phase, release from Cassini in deep space, and then the entry and the entry into an atmosphere, in fact, with the convection there. Because of the energy requirement we have, of course, we had to implement a totally passive system, which was not there, therefore not very easy to tune. To have the thermal control performed using RHUs provided by United States, because we have not in Europe. MLI, of course, for the control during the coast phase. And foam mounted inside the probe to block the convection during the descent. And this was a relatively exotic solution, and we had problem to set, to tune, in fact, this foam system. And do need two variables for adjustment, the number of RHUs and the size of a window, in fact, on the front shield. Thermal control has worked well in terms of, yes, it has maintained the temperature inside the specified range, not opening the figures. There are two comments. In fact, is that the temperature was a bit warmer, 7 degrees warmer at the beginning of the descent, which was favorable for the probe. I don't know for the instrument, but for the probe system, it was good. For the computer oscillator drift, it was very favorable, in fact. And on the bottom side of the instrument platform where the batteries are located, the temperature cooled down faster than predicted. You have here the plot. And it's believed to be due to not too efficient foam, in fact, around the SSP top hat, in fact. And this could explain this drop in temperature. But however, it was perfectly acceptable. Apart from the tuning, which is difficult, lessons learned is that Huygens could be done as it was designed thanks to RHUs. If we didn't have any RHUs to maintain the temperature of the probe during the cruise phase, we would have asked to Cassini to supply power. It may have been possible, but certainly not maintain the temperature for 22 days coast phase. So we would have had to reduce the coast phase to a few hours with an impossible impact on Cassini's side to avoid the impact with Titan, or to design another probe. So RHU is essential for this type of mission, or we design a carrier But okay, it's no more Huygens, which can be designed without RHUs. The avionics architecture was is a bit specific on Huygens compared to a normal satellite. Actually, it's derived from the Galileo probe architecture, where you have two hot redundant chains working in parallel. And this is it was very essential for the robustness. The failure, the fault protection was implemented by design. We didn't have to analyze any failure because any failure was recovered by the other chain. In fact, well, I go faster, but the there was some flexibility which we decided to implement by having patchable software, but not only well patchable. Of course, it could be patchable, but it was designed to be easily patchable. Okay, the way it has behaved well. One thing we can say is that the RUSO was not switched off on. It was a failure. It was an operational failure, not a technical failure. So one chain was lost, but only one chain was lost. There was no failure propagation. And without that architecture, I think we may have lost much more than half of the, well, half of the chains, in fact. Something important as well. The entry system or the mechanism for the entry detection was based on accelerometers. So we could test it on ground. We could verify its operation in flight, and it is important if we have to compare to G-switch-based solution. And so, I mean, as much as possible, the baseline solution has to be testable and even verifiable in flight. That's essentially all. The spin. Okay, I can go directly to the lessons learned to go faster because I'm very late, I think. So we all know that the spin reverted to the surprises of everybody after 9 minutes into the descent. This is still unexplained why it happened. Despite many tests were performed, it appeared that, again, the analysis of this test was probably not carefully enough performed because it was already seen in previous tests, so we have to go back to this verification. Okay, another thing is that, well, the measurement proposed for the spin was based on accelerometers. It was known to be inaccurate. It appeared to be inaccurate as predicted, so that's not a failure. But there was another solution which was considered during the development was based on coarse gyros to measure the spin. It was rejected because there was no flight qualification. So this solution, which was rejected on Huygens, is now used in Herschel, Planck, and Integral, for instance. It could have been used, and it could have been allowed easily to get the attitude of the probe during the whole descent in three axis, well, I would say with the same mass expense. But okay, for robustness reason, it was rejected. The altitude measurement, we all know what it's based on. It's a FMC W radar altimeter has been selected, also other solutions were considered. For that radar has worked has operated well from 16 kilometers down to the surface. So for that, it is, I mean, successful. Also, there are two main problems have occurred. Important problem is that from 25 to 16 kilometers, in fact, the two altimeters locked to a wrong altitude, wrong by 7 to 8 kilometers. So we have indicated to the instrument an altitude which was wrong by 7 to 8 kilometers during a certain time. And fortunately, we went back to the right altitude. And then there is a small discrepancy with the pressure and temperature measurement on the radar, which is another thing. The fact is that this radar were turned on to achieve a lock, to provide information from 60 kilometers to HASI. And we decided to take these into account from 25 kilometers in the algorithm. Unfortunately, it's a fact that they have been actually tested. Yeah. They've been actually tested. Yeah, I'm landing. So they've been tested in real condition from 3 kilometers altitude, while we wanted to operate them from 25 kilometers altitude. So that's a mistake. I mean, it was not tested. It would have flied. And we should have much stronger test plan for this altimeter. The status of the altimeter as well was unclear. I was in charge of that. Was unclear until the end because it was heavily used by the instruments, while it was used as well by the probe. So there was many tests performed by HASI on the altimeter, some tests performed at probe level. So actually, well, nobody knew really what this altimeter was in the end. This, maybe I can jump because Jean-Pierre has already spoken about it. Just go. We all know what happened for the telecom society. It has worked very well, in fact. It has provided very very valuable information in terms of science analysis. There is a poster from Miguel on that for the analysis of the surface based on the signal received by the orbiter. So that is very positive. The negative side is that this has worked very well after years spent to recover the mission. And millions of euros, so which is the bad side of it, and this could have been easily avoided. It's just that again, it was not tested in the condition it was used. So the Doppler was not applied on the data during the tests, and this was on purpose removed to save cost. Big mistake. And the algorithm in charge of the bit synchronization, the things which did not work well. Was implemented by software, and that software happened not to be patchable. Otherwise, the solution would have been, it would have been very, very simple to solve that problem, but the software was not patchable, so we had to redesign a complete mission. And so that's lessons learned. The software should be patchable. Energy storage, I go to the end directly is that, okay, it's good. The probe survived, in fact, was on for 10 hours and 20 minutes in total. It's huge. It's much more. It survived 3 hours and 20 minutes on the surface, which is all very, very favorable. We are all happy about that, but we can question whether it was not oversized to that respect and whether we could have made a better use either of the energy or the mass corresponding to the battery by taking things differently. Actually, we could have installed, we could have removed one battery, we could have installed a 5 kilos instrument, supplied 90 watts, and we could have still survived 2 hours on the ground, to give an idea. We could have increased the data rate by a factor of 2.5 with the energy we had available during the descent. Okay, of course, we had to have margins, that's clear. But maybe that margin could have been reassessed first because Galileo probe descent into this atmosphere with the same battery and the same module. It behaved very well at the end. So we had quite flight experience on that. So maybe we could have, at certain point, relaxed the margin and think about making use of the excess energy we may have. Jean-Pierre has addressed it, but think it before the mission, and probably the 3 hours spent on the ground were a bit useless, and 5 minutes would have been enough, maybe, or maybe half an hour. But okay, that's easy to say now. And I think that's it. I'm sorry, I was a bit longer.
5 minutes. You gave a wonderful talk, and as Jean-Pierre said, you're trying to summarize 20 years behind there. And this kind of talk, we should have given you at least an hour or 2 hours, because this is very interesting how things proceeded. It was amazing, and the things we learned. And you try to make it as lessons learned, you know, from the whole thing. So what I wanted to know is, from the past to the future, you mentioned a lot of things that had been seen during some of the tests that were made on the ground before the mission took off. And knowing what we know today, what do you think, in your own mind, this follows up from the discussion we had last night, what are the kinds of tests that you think would be useful at this point, one, to help with the science interpretation from the Huygens results, and two, to help with the future probe to Titan?
Okay, there was clearly for the spin, for instance, there is a lack of understanding. How a probe spins actually, or what has driven that spin during that descent. So Probably we have to go back into the SM2 tests. This was analyzed. No explanation was found at that time. We have to find an explanation, probably by doing another wind tunnel test, I guess, to try to understand that. Otherwise, we would do against exactly as it was designed, and the spin would be, we would reverse as well. I mean, if we. So that is an area. I think some of the wind tunnel tests were maybe interpreted a little bit too fast, also for the drag coefficients of the parachutes. Yeah. I would say it is. The things which were the most unclear, in fact.
Patrice, if given a chance, which single design decision you will make differently? Critical one, just one, not a series.
I remember of design decision or things we have accepted. Clearly, when we have accepted to have the receiver software not patchable, that was a mistake. We have, I know very well why, and we always enter in this discussion that it's not a software, it is a firmware and so on, but it was wrong. We could have saved a lot of money. Probably that one. Yeah.
This is just a statement, and you may have said it before because I came late. But don't ever hard code the flight software.
Okay, well, thanks again, Patrice, for this very interesting talk.